Bitte. In the previous video, we defined the multiplexer and showed how it serves the function of data selector, choosing one input to pass its data through to the output. In that video, the inputs and outputs were all single bits. Not surprisingly, we can use a MUX to select groups of bits. In this video, we will show 4-bit examples. The pattern here could be extended to inputs of any size. In this schematic, it looks like we have 10 different inputs, a select and an enable up top, and 8 separate data inputs on the left. In one sense, that is correct, but here we are interpreting the data inputs as coherent 4-bit numbers. Notice how they are labeled A3, A2, A1, A0, and B3, B2, B1, B0. This means that bits A3 through A0 do not work independently of each other, but work together to represent a larger number. For example, if they are an unsigned binary number, then input A could hold the value of decimal 15. This means that our multiplexer should never select A3 along with B2. If we choose A, then we choose all of A and ignore all of B. So, despite the many input bits, we only need a single select switch to decide whether the 4 output bits come from A or B. The gate structure is similar to what we saw before for 1-bit inputs. This top OR gate, for example, is choosing between A3 and B3. If S equals 1, then A3 is allowed to pass through the AND gate and reach the OR gate. Meanwhile, the B3 value is ignored with its AND gate, forced to output 0. Conversely, if S equals 0, then the B3 passes through and A3 is ignored. The exact same pattern is used for deciding between A2 and B2, A1 and B1, A0 and B0. Of course, all of this depends on the circuit being enabled, which is controlled by the EN input. In this case, we have an active low enable due to this NOT gate. If EN equals 1, the MUX is inactive and all of the outputs are forced to be 0. On this slide, we take advantage of a fact we just noticed. Each individual bit of the 4-bit MUX is selected with the same strategy as a 1-bit MUX. So, we use a 1-bit MUX device, as explained in the previous video. Notice how this top device accepts the data inputs for A3 and B3. One of them is selected by this select signal and passes through to the output. The repetitive pattern for all the remaining bits is even clearer in this layout. One functional difference between this circuit and the one in the previous slide is the lack of an enable signal. This particular setup does not provide that option, so this circuit is always active. I also want to emphasize one subtle but important notation difference, the naming of the select input. On the previous slide, it was called S, which is reasonable since that is short for select. However, a more explicit name is A/B'. The slash in the name indicates that this is a control switch. Through it, we can choose either the first operation or the second. And the placement of the prime tells us what a 1 or 0 would accomplish. Here, the prime is next to B, so 0 selects B, and 1 selects A. This strategy of explicit notation feels clunky at first. We usually like our variables to be single letters. But it is very useful in device symbols to explain the operation. Between the name on the device, MUX, and the label on this input, anyone should be able to pick up your device and use it accurately. Let's hop over to the simulator to see a 4-bit multiplexer in action. I like showing this example because it makes an abstract idea much more concrete. Inside the device, there are many gates and wires, but zoomed out to this level, we see there are simply 3 inputs, A, B, and select, and 1 output. Let's pick arbitrary values for A and B by clicking on the hex keyboards. Now, to let the MUX select the A value, we flip the switch to 1. and to select the B value, we flip the switch to 0. While this switch is 0, we can change this A input to anything, and it has no impact on the output. But then we flip the switch back to 1, and A is important again. This is all that a multiplexer does, accepts multiple inputs, and chooses one of them to pass through to the output. Now let's look at an example of multiplexing that you are probably familiar with if you are watching this video, an internet router. This basic diagram shows the four key components, the worldwide network that is the internet, the modem and router in your house, and the individual devices that you are using to connect to the internet. When you are downloading information, it moves along the down arrows from the internet to your device. But you could also upload, which would follow the same arrows in reverse. The name modem is actually short for modulator demodulator. Its function is to convert from analog signals to digital signals, or in the other direction. Your devices work in digital, but the cable running down your street and connecting to your house sends analog signals, which are more conducive for long-distance transmission. That's all interesting, but the real connection to this lesson is the router. There is one cable coming from the modem, but there are multiple devices that might be connected to the same modem. In this diagram, we see three. At any one instant, only one of those devices can be sending or receiving a signal through the modem. The router decides which one. In the case of uploading, multiple lines feed in, but only one signal passes through. This is a multiplexer operation. In the case of downloading, one signal feeds in and needs to be directed to the proper device. You don't want to click on a CSE120 video and see your roommate's Frolicking Unicorns video instead. This is the reverse of multiplexing, and is called demultiplexing. We'll discuss demultiplexers next video. So this is one example of data routing in action. I hope it gives you a sense of the necessity of controlled data selection. It is also extremely important for sending signals within an individual computer. We will take advantage of muxes and demuxes numerous times as we design more circuits in this course.